Receive the double anointing.
Bless God.
Bless God. Go back and listen. If you didn't have an opportunity to participate in midweek, go back and listen and be blessed and be encouraged and be uplifted. We all have things, especially during this time, that we are going through. So now is the time to even draw closer. Now is not the time to fall back and make excuses. Now is the time to come closer to God and to seek Him so that He can give you revelation in the midst of the chaos. We already talked about there is no peace without order. So let's incorporate His order so we can walk in His peace. Bless God. And there's no announcements, right? There is an announcement. Today is the 6th anniversary of Trinity Tabernacle. Bless God. Thank God for His servant and for His servant's humility and servitude. Reach out to Pastor Robinson and congratulate him for walking in obedience and for doing the work of the Lord. Bless God. So we'll go on to intercessory prayer. Father, we just thank You again for this brand new day. We thank You, Father, for how You have kept us throughout another week. We thank You, Almighty God, for Your sustaining grace. We thank You for Your love, for Your mercy, for Your peace that Your word describes surpasses all understanding, that no matter what I'm going through, that if I come to You, Father, that You can give me rest, You can give me peace, You can give me soundness of mind. I can feel Your love and Your grace and Your mercy. And we thank You for that this morning, oh God. We know that there are people who are troubled in their spirit and afflicted in their bodies, oh God, who are in prison, Father, and not just naturally, but spiritually. But we thank You because You are the great I Am. You are the Redeemer. You are the lifter of heads. And all we have to do is draw close to You. And as we reach out to You, Your word says that You would come near to us. So we stand in faith this morning on Your word, declaring that it will be so, not just for us, but others. Every single person who is logged in at this time and at a time to come, oh God, that You would begin to remove those things that are causing them to stumble, that You would begin to raise them above every situation, that You would increase them and enlarge their borders, oh God, because we know that there is nothing impossible for You, and we bless Your holy and righteous name this morning. We call You holy. We call You wonderful. We call You King of Kings, oh God. We exalt You this morning above circumstance. We exalt You this morning above a feeling. Whatever it is, oh God, we trust You, Father. And we lean not to our own understanding, but we trust You, Father. We thank You, Almighty God. We thank You, Father, for a renewed mind this morning, that no evil shall overtake us, but we are covered in the blood of Jesus. We rebuke every foul spirit that attempts to come against our mind this morning and to cause us to believe the lie. And we receive Your promise this morning. We thank You, Almighty God. We thank You, Father. Thank You, oh God. Thank You, Father. Begin to worship Him this morning above your circumstance. Begin to exalt Him, oh God. Thank You, Father. We exalt You this morning. We exalt Your holy and righteous name. We exalt You, oh God. Not the circumstance, not the affliction, but You, oh God. We exalt You this morning. We thank You, Father. Thank You for Your provision. Thank You for Your healing hand. Thank You for Your love and for Your mercy. Thank You for sustaining us, Almighty God. Battles that we didn't even know we were fighting, oh God. But because of You, Father, because we are Your children, Your heirs, oh God, You have kept us. And every single thing that comes that tries to cause us to doubt your word. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus. We ask that you would silence the mouth of the enemy and allow us to look back on your goodness and your mercy, how you've kept us, oh God. No one but you. And we bless you, oh God. Now, Lord, we pray for those who are sick and shut in, for those who are homeless, for those who are in prison, for those who are oppressed and depressed, oh God. We ask, Father, that you would begin to move, that your Holy Spirit would begin to walk up and down various streets and neighborhoods and cities and states and the entire nation and world, oh God, that your Spirit would begin to flow. Your word declares that if your people who are called by your name would humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from their wicked ways, that then you would hear from heaven and you would heal the land. Cause us to cry out to you, oh God, not just when we're in need, but when we see things in this world that we don't like. Cause us to stand up in our spirit and to pray on behalf of others, oh God. We know, Father, that it's already done, that the victory is already ours. But in the meantime, Father, we praise you. In the meantime, we cry out to you, and we ask that this would be a fragrant offering that comes up before you, and that when you hear your children calling, Father, that you would turn and you would answer, and that you would heal this land, Father. That you would begin to bring souls back unto you, that laborers would be placed in their path, Father, and that every work of darkness must cease in the almighty name of Jesus. Allow us to be reminded that just a little bit of light casts out darkness. Yes. Allow us to be the light of the world as you have called us to be. Now, Lord, have your way in this service today. Use your servant, Father, as you see fit. We lift him up before you, O God, and we rebuke any negative words that may have been spoken. We call them null and void of effect, and we thank you, Father, that because he bows before you, that he can stand before anyone. Continue to use him, Father. Anoint him. From the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, we thank you, Father, and bless every single listener, Father. We ask that you would cultivate the ground in their hearts so that this word is planted on good ground and that it is received. In the almighty name of Jesus, we pray this and so many unspoken prayers of the heart. Bless God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Praise God for this day and for what this day stands for and all that it shall accomplish. It's good to be amongst the land. It's good to be amongst the living, still fighting for righteousness. Today we have, as Lady Gwendolyn said this in the announcements, it's our 6th anniversary, and that's a good thing. Yeah.
Bless God.
That
six
God
years.
Continues to use us to declare his word to yes. his people. But there is a word this morning from the Lord. You don't mind turning your books to Jeremiah chapter 1. There's another Bible sitting in there. Turn it off. Jeremiah. Chapter 1, and I'm reading from the King James Version this morning, verses number 4 through verse 10. That's Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through verse 10. And it says this, then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I was formed in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee a prophet unto the nation. Then said I, Lord, our Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Verse number 8, be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down and to build and to plant. Praise God.
Praise God.
I want to talk to you this morning about until God's word is fulfilled, don't settle. Until God's word is fulfilled, do not settle. Father God, we thank you for your word, God. We ask that you would make it become life and light unto us so that we will be able to use it for morsels, for meat, as for direction. God, I decrease that you might increase, that you might use me to plant seeds unto your sheep. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Praise God. You may be seated wherever you are. Until God's word is fulfilled, do not settle. Don't settle. Don't settle. Settling is something that a lot of people have become accustomed to. And it's unfortunate because settling says that I have forfeit what God declared was mine. When I settle, I decide, I make the decision that I've gone as far as I should go versus believing where God says that he has already placed me to be. So whenever I settle, I destroy, I sabotage, I give up the promise that God has already said is mine. I'm settling, is compromising what I know God has said concerning me, his servant, regardless of the season that I'm in, regardless of the experiences that I have going on, regardless of how I feel, regardless of how heavy things are going, how heavy things feel to me right now. Settling says that I don't trust God. Don't settle. Don't settle. He never said that the road would be easy. For if it was easy, everybody would do it. Now, I'm not talking about easy as in or brain surgery. But what I'm talking about, difficulties of like trusting God. It's difficult to trust God because you see what you see. It's difficult to believe in God because you believe what you know. It's difficult to hear God because you hear what you hear others echoing in your mind. It's difficult to trust God. It's difficult to lean on God. It's difficult to understand God because you're looking at everything from a worldly perspective. So if it was easy, everybody would be blessed and highly favored. But it's difficult because you have to overcome you. And when you overcome you, the walk will become clearer. You'll understand that the hardships are there for pruning. Yes. They're there for refining. They're there for rebuking. They're there to build you up so that you become this new man, this new woman that God has created in you. But if you settle, you have forfeited the promise that God says is yours. Until God's word in you is fulfilled, don't settle. We settle in many things. We settle in relationships because they don't do what we want them to do or expect them to do what we expect them to do. But we don't want to be by ourselves. We'll choose somebody that just checks off a couple of boxes, but they don't check off the things that are important to you. They don't check off the things that really make you to be alive in the relationship. So you're in a relationship for several years because you just decided to settle all along knowing that this relationship isn't fulfilling. Stop settling. We settle for jobs because we need finances, we need resources, but you've been overlooked for promotion time and time after again. You've been overshadowed because of your gender, because of your race, and they promoted people above you that didn't have any experience. People that you trained, they promoted, but you stayed there 6 more years because you needed the job you you settled. You settled in your education because you only believed that you were only supposed to go this far. But God gave you a vision of a PhD, a doctoral degree. God gave you visions beyond where you are. But you settled because you said, it's too difficult. I can't manage the online classes. I can't go here and go there. My workload and my household are just too difficult. So I settled for the associate. You settled. Stop settling. I settled because I wanted to exercise and I wanted to bring my body to a different level. But because the exercises were rigorous, because the diet was challenging, instead of me losing the weight, I just bought an extra size clothes and just became comfortable with who I am. Instead of going where you declared you wanted to be, stop settling. We settle in everything we do. But God has already spoken a promise that he's waiting to fulfill if you just trust God. If you just trust God with what he said about you, where you're supposed to be, how you're supposed to live, what you're supposed to speak, what you're supposed to see, believe, where you're supposed to anoint, where you're supposed to declare. If you just trust God with everything, even the things that you think you got control over, trust God with that, you'll see that God will begin to explode things around. You'll see that the favor that you've been seeking after has already been near to you. But because you're trying to work in your own strength and in your own might, you're forfeiting the blessing because you're settling for what I want now. God says, stop settling. You won't get the victory by settling. Because the victory comes through triumph. Triumph says that I overcome. I overcome adversity. I overcome experiences that don't benefit me right now. I overcome my emotions. I overcome my hardships. I overcome my pain, my tragedy, my experience. I overcome because I'm in Jesus, because God's with me, because he already declared that I have victory because I'm righteous in him. If I don't settle, I overcome. Most people have compromised where they are, where they're supposed to be in life, by settling. Imagine where you could be if you wouldn't have forfeited what God showed you was yours if you would have just opened the next door. If you would have just took another walk. If you would have just looked at it from a different perspective. If you would have just prayed on it before you responded. If you would have just and listen to the spirit that was whispering in your mind instead of what you see going on around you. Imagine where you could be right now. The scripture that Lady Gwendolyn prayed this morning, if my people who are called by my name, there's a powerful word in there that we overlook. The word is then. Because then denotes that once you do this, God is going to do that. Once you get here, God is going to do this. But the only way God can do this or do that is if you do your part. The if. We stumble, we settle because of the if is too difficult. Because the if says that I might not know what's on the other side. But the trusting God, loving God, yeah, leaning on God, believing God, says I don't have to know what's on the other side as long as God is on the other, yes, side. I don't have to know what's going to lie in front of me as long as I trust that God led me down that path. I don't have to know what the enemy looks like because I believe that God has already given me victory, yeah, over every Goliath, over every hardship, over every pain, over every stumbling block. I don't have to see it. I just know that God gave me a revelation and I haven't got there. Therefore, the word that he put in me, it will not return back void until it accomplishes, yes, that thing, yes, that he, God, has set it in. So I'm not going to settle. Even when it feels hard, I'm not going to settle. Even when it looks difficult, I'm not going to settle. Because difficulty and hardness is the enemy trying to push me away from where God says that I'm supposed to be. Anything that you want to do that goes beyond who you're supposed to be or what you're supposed to do is always easy. It's easy to do the things that bring pain and trouble and trauma and grieves your spirit. It's easy because it's the enemy that is promoting it. But to do the thing that God has created you to do is going to be difficult because you're getting pushback, not just from the people around you, but because the enemies, they're trying to force you into believing something that God has already whispered in your spirit. Stop settling until God's word is fulfilled in you. Stop settling. He comes to Jeremiah, the prophet. Jeremiah is a prophet. He's one of the minor, he's one of the major prophets in the Bible, which means that he prophesies a lot of things, just not one or two things. He deals with a great wide perspective of prophecies. But Jeremiah was at the position where he was coming into who he was. Even though he was born with a certain degree of blessings, he had to come into that, which means that he had to change his mind, his opinion about who he thought he was. See, he thought he was just born from a family lineage, but his family roots was deeper than that because he was going to be used by God. So that's why the word says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew you. Verse number 5. It's important for us to understand that before our parents got together, before the doctors knew the gender, before an expected delivery date was already assigned, that God knew you, knowing you, that God has already declared that you will be great, knowing you, that God already says, I'm going to have my hand and my hedge on them, that they can do whatever they desire. I will give them their heart's desire. I just need them to trust me. He told Jeremiah, before I formed you in the belly, I knew you. Before you came out, before your birth date, before the doctors pulled you and plucked you out of your mother's womb, before they spanked you and you cried, I formed thee and I sanctified thee. In other words, God says, before you breathed your first natural breath, I had already anointed you to do great things. I had already declared a promise over you because I need you to be the prophet unto nations. Everybody has an assignment. Your assignment may not be mine, but everybody has an assignment. And God has already ordained you, already sanctified you for that assignment. You just have to believe it. He gives it to you in revelation, in dreams. He gives it to you in desires. He's already given you the prophecy of what you're supposed to be. You just have to trust God. But here's where we fall. See, Jeremiah was okay with being born, right? He was okay being in this particular family, doing whatever the family business was. And he comes out of the gate deciding, you know what, I'm going to settle. I don't need all of that extra business that you got for me, God. I don't need to be widely known. I don't need folks to be calling upon me. I don't need to be praying for folks. That's not what I want to do. What I want to do is I just want to be what my daddy was. And what I want to do is I want to take on the family business, be a sharecropper, deal with the sheep and the livestock, plant a few seeds, pick a few herbs. That's what I want to do. I don't want to do that. So Jeremiah says, I'm just a little child. I don't know what I'm supposed to say, God. I can't do that which you've asked me to do because that's an enormous assignment. That's a big task. That goes beyond, I haven't seen anybody. Oh, this is a bad thing, what we do. I haven't seen anybody in my family achieve that yet. So how do you think that I can achieve it? I don't have the roadmap for that. I don't have the blueprint for it. It's not in my bloodline to do it. I can't go no further than what they did. My education already exceeded my mother's by graduating high school. Why do you want me to go any further? God says, don't say that. Because if you're my child, right? If you're God's child, right? If your heritage goes beyond your family name, then you're God's child. And God will do for his children what he needs to do in order for them to get to where he already declared that they should be. Jeremiah wanted to settle. He wanted to settle in his mind. But God, because God is a, God knows how to reassure, right? God knows how to give confidence. God knows how to listen, not just by what they say, but how they respond, body language and emotions and feelings. God knows how to look at you from a full angle, just not what you present to God. God says, no, that's not. Let that not be true. That's not true. Yes, you might be a child, but you're a child of the King. Yes, you might be young, but I'll grow you up with spiritual wisdom. Yes, your family may have never done anything like this, but I'm going to use you to show the rest of your family that there's nothing too hard for God. So Jeremiah wanted to settle, but God would not let him settle because God was going to use Jeremiah. And so God reached forth and he did something to Jeremiah that he's done for us on a daily basis. We just haven't recognized it. The word said that God reached out and God touched the mouth of Jeremiah because that was Jeremiah's complaint. Jeremiah says, I can't speak like that. That was the same complaint that Moses had when God said that I'm going to send you to the children of Israel. I'm going to send you to talk to the king. But Moses says, no, I can't speak eloquently. In other words, Moses was saying that every now and then I stutter because I can't get the words out of my mouth. But God says, no, don't say that because I will use you. You're going to be my mouthpiece. And whatever my mouthpiece is supposed to say, I can make your lips form the right way. I can make your tongue do whatever it's supposed to do. I can make your vocal cords order the right noises. I can do whatever I have to do to ensure that you are going to accomplish whatever I said that you were created for. He says, I'm not going to let you fail. That's something that you and I should take with us. That even though it seems difficult, even though it seems like the roadblock is every at every juncture in this is always some trouble, God says, I'm not going to let you fail. I can't let you fail because I gave you the gift. I gave you the dream. I can't let you fail. If I let you fail, then I fail. But what you can't do is intentionally fail. You can't settle. You can't settle. If you refuse the blessing, then that's on you. But you won't fail as long as you accept what I'm giving you. If I'm giving you the tools, accept the tools. Use the resources that I'm providing for you. If you just do it like I declared, then you will be okay. Verse 9 said that he said, well, let me skip back. He said, verse number 7, Then the Lord said, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak for I am a child. This is Jeremiah. Verse number 7 says, but the Lord said unto me, say not I am a child, for thou shalt go to where I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command, thou shalt speak. And be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, says the Lord. Do you know that the journey is always filled with unknown circumstances?
Right.
Especially if you're the first one that's plotting the course. You don't have the ability, the experience to be able to pull off of other people's experiences that they've been down the road. But be rest assured that as long as God is with you, he says you don't have to be afraid. Afraid comes from a word that means a choice. It's a choice. It's almost like fear. But it's because you've seen something. Now you continue to choose to believe that way or to operate in that capacity because of what you expect to happen. Because of the whispers that you have heard about other people that have failed. God says, don't be afraid. Because along this entire journey, from the beginning of time, I was with you. When you make a step,
yes,
I'll be with you. If you fall, I'll be there to pick you up. If you run, I'll run right alongside with you. But don't you dare be afraid, because no kingdom children of mine are afraid of anything that I've already put beneath you. See, when you're confident about what you have, you're not afraid, because you're confident in that. Can't nobody take away that from you. Can't nobody outdo you in that, because you're confident in your talent and your skills. But when it comes to the unknown, the thing that I haven't done before, the thing like patience, the thing like trust, the thing like having an unwavering faith, when it comes down to doing things that I haven't done before, now I become afraid because it goes against what I've already experienced. And this is a new journey for me. God says, don't be afraid, for I'm there with thee to deliver thee, says the Lord. Then he says that I'm putting my hand on his mouth so that I can give him what he was afraid of, that he didn't have. I'll give it to him now, so he doesn't have any excuses. How many excuses have we exhausted about trying to go where God called us to go? How many excuses have we subjected ourselves to on why we can't get to the destination? It's too difficult, Lord. I'm all by myself, God. No one really could understand it like I understand it, God. I can't seem to get the resources. But if God gave you the vision, do you think that our God, how great our God is, how mighty our God is, will just give you a vision and not the resources for the vision? He's not a cruel God. The word says that he's a good God, a good father, and he knows how to give good gifts. So if he gave you the vision, if he gave you the revelation, if he gave you the dream for it, rest assured that he will give you the resources for it. But you have to trust God. You have to, as the word says, lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your path. You have to get out of your own way. It's your own mind that is causing you to have these hardships, these difficulties, these fears, these phobias, these troubles, these concerns. It's all your own imagination that is causing this agony and the grief. God says, if you just step aside and let me be God, I'll tell you that before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before you came out of your mother's womb, I sanctified thee and I adorned you to be a prophet over nations. God gave Jeremiah a title, a task, and a kingdom before he was able to cook. Because he's God. Before you were able to utter your first word, God had already given you the victory. What happened is you settled. We settled just for just enough. I settle for I'll be all right with this. But along with the settling comes some complaining, because you know I'm better than this. Because you know that this just doesn't feel right. I'm not supposed to be here, but I'm here because I gotta pay the bill. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. But God has given you a bigger dream than just that. Imagine what would happen if you just take another step. If you would just trust a little harder. The Proverbs 13 and 12 says, hope deferred sickens a heart, but desire realized is like a tree of life. Essentially, the proverbial author is trying to say that, yes, it's okay that you don't have it now. But as long as you believe and continue to long forward, that when you get it, it will bring about a thanksgiving that will satisfy all of the hardship that you had to do to get there. Even though it felt like it was a long journey, when it occurs, the Bible says that you will forget about all of the pain because you stayed the journey. You got to continue the journey. You can't allow what you see to disrupt what God told you it shall be. Jeremiah wanted to settle, but God's promise had not been fulfilled. Jeremiah wanted to put Jeremiah's agenda in front of God's promise by saying to God, I'm just a child. I can't speak. But God says that even as a child, I can use you to speak. Even if you don't understand what I'm telling you to say, I still can use you to make a difference. Even if you don't think that they're going to value or what you say, I'll still use you to plant a seed. And because I'm God and you plant a seed, then I'll do the watering and I'll give an increase because I'm God. But I need you to go and open up your bag and drop the seeds as I send you off. Stop settling. If you feel uncomfortable about where you are, it's probably because you're settled. Because you're settled for something that seemed easy, or it fit the mold for where you are right now. But it doesn't match up or align to where God says that you're supposed to be. So you have to get back to the place where you say, okay, Lord, I trust you. I may not understand it, but I will trust you. And I will trust you means that you don't have to give me all of the details. But if you just tell me the next thing to do, without me knowing what is going to cause me, or without me knowing who is going to offend God, I'm going to do it because I trust you. I believe you, God. I love you and I thank you that you're using me for this particular reason and for this purpose. You have to get back into the alignment with God. You have to get back into alignment with God so that the vision that he casts for you doesn't diminish. It doesn't go away. You don't get old and you never become that with God, and you don't have those wish I should have, could have, would have kind of things. God wants to do something great in you. But he can't do it if you're just going to settle. If you're just going to accept what the world gives you, then why do you need God? You're going to allow what they say about you to become who you are, then why do you need God? We need God because we need to overcome every stumbling block, every hurdle, every assignment that the enemy is trying to put out there against us. We need God to overcome those things because we can't focus on that and trust God at the same time. I've got to be able to trust God and let him deal with all of those things that are trying to destroy me. Mm-hmm. And I focus on doing what God called me to do and believe that God has already dispatched angels, that he's already has us, what's the word, says that the hedge of protection is already around us. Yes. And that they're ready to engage whenever somebody gets out of line with his people. The Lord says, touch not thou, anointed to do thy prophet no harm. You have to know who you are. Yes, you might have a social security number, but that's not who you are. Yes, you may have a name, but that's not who you are. Yes, you might look a certain way, resemble someone else in the family, but that's not who you are. It goes deeper than that. You belong to God. You're an heir of God. You're an anointed child of God. You're his called out, his royal, his peculiar. You his made in his image and after his likeness. You are the image of God. It's more than your name, more than your title, more than your family lineage. You are the walking ambassadors for God. So what do? Because you settle. Your settling and my settling gonna be different. And they may actually be the same. But at some point in time, you have settled. And because you've served, Jeremiah would have forfeited. Verse number, let's see, where is it at? He would have forfeited verse number 10. And Jeremiah would have been allowed to sell. God says, this is what I'll do. See, I have set this day to set you over the nations. He would have forfeited. He would have forfeited that. And the kingdoms, he would have forfeited those. To root out, he would have forfeited that. To pull down, he would have forfeited that. To destroy, he would have forfeited that. To throw down, he would have forfeited that. To build, he would have forfeited that. And to plant, he would have forfeited that if he was allowed to sell. Now imagine what you haven't done. He was doing all that in Jeremiah, in little old Jeremiah, before he was of age. He was going to do all that through Jeremiah. Imagine what your settling has done to where the nations and the kingdoms, they aren't impacted because you settled. The destruction and the mayhem that they say and whispered throughout the atmosphere, that it's not rooted up nor is it pulled down because you settle. That you can't change the narrative about how they see us because you settle. And you can't build. You can't plant. You don't make any progress because you settle. Now change the narrative and say, God, I'm tired of settling. I'm tired of settling. Because settling only made me comfortable. You know, I'd rather be uncomfortable but trusting you. I'd rather not know, but believe that you've already secured the bag, Father, because you're God. I'd rather just lean on you, O God. I'd rather just trust in you, O God. I'd rather depend on you, O God. I'd rather move the way you say move. I'd rather say the way what you tell me to say. I'd rather hear the way that you tell me to hear because I trust you. Cancel out the noise. Diminish all the distractions, God. Give me peace that surpasses all understanding because I'm tired of settling. I know that where I am isn't where I'm supposed to be. There is greater things out there. There's a bigger assignment for me than what I am doing right now. And I'm not just talking about you're on the way, right? Because we have to go through things to get where we're supposed to. I'm talking about you sat down. You've taken a seat. You've locked the door. You've rolled up the windows. You've changed the address. You've put a do not disturb sign outside the building. I'm talking about you have just changed the whole narrative about where God says you're supposed to be. Not you're on the journey. Because on the journey is trusting God. But you've just changed the whole course of the river by putting up a dam and blocking all of the resources that were supposed to flow into you. And now you've settled with a pond. God says, there's nothing I do that's pond-like. I'm a great, mighty,
yes,
rushing river. I'm not a pond. I'm everything. I'm all things. And I'm in you if you just let me stop settling. Until God's word, whatever he has poured into you, whatever he has spoken into your spirit is fulfilled. Don't settle. Because when you settle, you tell the enemy you won. You tell the enemy you are right. What was I thinking that I could accomplish this task? You are right. I'll just take my 9 to 5, I'll work my fingers to the bone, and I won't try to do anything outside what they tell me to, because they are my masters, not God. Whenever you say, you forfeit what God says was supposed to be yours. But there's good news, right? There's good news. Like Jeremiah, God didn't let him settle. He sent Jesus for you so that you don't have to settle. That you don't have to use your past as a weapon to keep you away from doing the work. That you can be righteous before God because you believe that Jesus was the Son of God and God raised him from the dead. He's given you the way out, he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and 13, that he makes a way of escape.
Yes.
That you know the way of escape. And the way of escape is through Jesus. But you have to choose it. You have to walk through it for yourself. Settling says that even though I see the sign of exit, I'm all right here. I don't really want what's on the other side of that door. I got enough right here. Until the lights get cut off. Until the pipes get frozen and we have no water. Until there's too much ice on the road and we realize that our houses wasn't sufficient enough. That we didn't have enough resources, enough supplies. The last 3 days. Because we failed to take care of the basic things. Like insulation. Like having enough extra supplies just in case. Driving on E. God said, you've been doing it for too long. It's time now to stop settling. So what do you do? What do you do? 1 Corinthians 10:13 says he made a way of escape. For you and I, to get away from this settled mindset, you have to choose that, walk through that door for yourself. Bible declares that he sits at the door and he knocks. And he said, anybody that opens the door unto me, I'll come in and I'll sit with him. He's patiently waiting for you. Even while you struggle, God's still there just waiting for you, wondering when you're going to change your mind, your opinion about that thing. I'm hoping that you don't think that you have to get to a certain age to be able to trust God. Hoping that you don't have to think that you have to belong to a certain church, certain denomination to be in the fellowship of God. Hoping that you just say, you know, because you are mine, because you made me, that I already belong to you. I just have to believe that I belong to you and stop settling for belonging to a society that don't deem you worthy anyway. He said, I'll open my arms unto you if you just come in. You have to make the choice for yourself. You have to make the choice for yourself. So that was Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through 10, and Proverbs 13, 12. A look at Jeremiah. And when you read the rest of that chapter, you'll see that God, he requested some things of Jeremiah to perform so that Jeremiah knew that God was doing a wonderful work in him. The next 4 verses after that, so that Jeremiah just wasn't left without anything to lean on to increase his faith, that God did something to show him that he was God. He was proving himself to God. Oh, and I'll say this, thank you, Holy Spirit, that we serve a God that knows how to humor us, right? Because he knows that we have wavering faith. And that sometimes we have to see or hear something supernatural for us to believe the supernatural. And sometimes he does that by giving the revelation to someone else concerning what you need and placing it in your spirit and then having that person call you and tell you the exact same thing that God told you for you to believe. Sometimes he even goes even further, like what he did for Hezekiah, when Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he was dying and he asked God to show him a sign. And God says, because I am God, this is what I'll do for you. This will be the sign that I am God and that the promise that I says for you is real, that I'll turn the time back, that I'll make the shadow, the sun go back 10 degrees so that you believe. We serve a God that is able to satisfy your unbelief by showing you that you can trust and depend on him. But you have to make your request known unto God. Whatever that is that you need God to show you, for you to know that he is God, whatever that is, I'm not talking about tempting God. Don't walk out in front of the street and say, Lord, if you're God, and I get hit by this bus, I'm not going to die. Don't do that. That's foolishness. Right? But if there are simple things in your life that, I need an answer to, Lord, I'm struggling with this and I've been wrestling with this, that very same answer can come just like that because he's God. And it doesn't have to come just to you. He can send it to someone else that will bring it to you, and you'll know that that was God, because they did not know what you were dealing with. Only the word, the will, and the might of God exposed them to that so that you would believe. So we have to ensure that we don't allow anything to prohibit us from trusting God. Don't sell. So go back and read that whole chapter and continue with the book. Jeremiah is a great book. Great illustrations on trusting God, what God does through his people. And you'll find yourself in there somewhere. And so today you have a challenge ahead of you. You have to uproot yourself from where you are right now and leave that thing behind. Because that subtle spirit finds its way in everything that you do. Not just where God is trying to take you to, but everything else that you do along the journey, that settling spirit will take over. You have to realize that the enemy doesn't play fairly. He doesn't just destroy your faith. He also tries to destroy everything around you to keep your faith destroyed. And he'll do that by whatever tactics or tools or people that he needs to. So we have to give it all to God. We have to give it all to God and uproot that settled mindset. Praise God. So I hope something that was said, right, will help you today. Change your tomorrow so that you are walking in total liberty and not handcuffed, shackled to a settled mindset, that you're free and free indeed. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed.
Bless God.
Bless God. So we always want to offer a salvation to everyone, and not assume that because you come to a church and because you can read scriptures or memorize scriptures or prayed or come from a house that were generations of believers that you are actually saved. Right. It's about a choice. It's a personal choice that you're saved and that you want to have a relationship with God for yourself, so that he could use you regardless of whose family you belong to, regardless of what you've done in the past, that he can use you and occupy the space in your heart for his love and not the love of the world. So that's a personal thing that you have to do for yourself. So the word of God says that if you believe in your heart, confess with your mouth that God raised Jesus from the dead, and therefore you'll be saved. Now, that word believe, it seems like a simple word, but it constitutes a lot of things. You have to be sincere about in your heart of what you believe. Just as you're confident about you walking outside and looking up and seeing the color of the sky, or confident about you walking without having to tell your legs to move left and right, you have to believe that he is who he says he is, and that he died for those that he said he was dying for, and that God, his Father, raised him from a dead state so that you could be saved. You have to believe it with all of your heart, might, and your strength. He said, and then if you do that, then thou shalt be saved. So after that, we know that baptism was an ordinance that was practiced both in the Old and New Testament. And baptism, our Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, he did it. John baptized him by the water of Jordan. It's an act of our faith. What goes down comes up clean, comes up full of the anointing, the Holy Spirit of God, the fire of God, dipped and baptized in it. So that after you're saved, we're baptized in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Now we know churches are not in full capacity, and they may not be able to be baptized the traditional way. But don't let that be an excuse. You can find a tub, you can find a body of water, whatever you need in order to satisfy the whole experience. We believe that we serve a God that is faithful and that he will allow that to be sufficient for the cause. So salvation, then baptism. And then we also want to offer a prayer for those that are, you've settled, right? You know God. You've walked with God. You've heard God's voice. And you're not afraid to confess Jesus in front of unbelievers. You love God. But something happened. Something shifted the tides in your life. And now you're stuck with accepting and allowing whatever the day brings, you're okay with it. But you know that there is more for you that you have to do than what you're doing. So let's pray together. Tasha Cobbs has a song called Break Every Chains. Let's break every chain that the enemy has bound to you today. And let's do that in faith for one another. So we don't have to know your circumstances. We don't need to know your reasons. We just know that you decide that you want to be free. And we're going to pray together. Then the last one is just, there are just times where we want to be closer to God. Lord, just draw me closer. There's no particular thing that I can think about that I need. I love you. I'm doing what you called me to do. I just want to thank you. All right. And so let's do that today all together as well. We just thank God, celebrate and worship and reverence God for who he is. So whatever your need is, wherever you align, don't let a settled mind keep you from being saved. Don't let a settled mind keeping you from seeking to be drawn nearer to God. Don't let a settled mind keep you from worshiping and reverencing God. Let's be free today. So the doors of the church are always open. They're never closed. So wherever you are, whatever you need, you make that declaration for yourself. And we will gladly help you transition into the new you and leave that old you behind. Praise God. So let us stand and let us pray. If there's something that we need to do here, just come forward here and we'll pray together. The word says, make your request be known unto God, and the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will keep you in Christ Jesus. So let us do that. Here as well as wherever you are, man, wherever you're viewing from, that you do it there. And we believe that the Spirit of God is everywhere. Even in through the internet, through remote places from one another, that the Spirit of God is there. So Father God, we thank you for being ever so present. We thank you, O God, for your word, for your reminder, that you've already established greatness in us, that you've already established a purpose in us, that you've already given us the resources and the tools, that you've already established your unfailing love for us. Father, just let us trust you. Let us learn to be disciplined enough to lean onto you, to give you all of our cares and our concerns. Let us be sincere enough to show you, God, where we struggle so that you can help us overcome these things that have settled us to a place that has compromised our integrity, our relationship, our position with you, God. Lord, we just cling to you today, asking that you would abolish, that you would remove, that you would destroy every yoke of the enemy, that us, your people, shall be free. We declare victory today. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We declare victory today that none of your children, whether they be young or old or whatever nationality they are, or gender that they are, that they be free and free indeed, that you break every chain, every stronghold that the enemy has from your people today, God. We declare it in Jesus' name, Lord. We thank you, God, for the victory that you've already promised us, Master. So, Father, for those that desire to be saved, God, you know their names, you know their needs, you know their location, God. We ask that you would send forth the blood of Jesus, Lord, that it would rest upon them, that they will be changed and be made to new creations, oh God, that they will be anointed, that the Holy Spirit will drop down upon them, oh God, and they will talk with a new talk. They will hear and see differently, oh God. They will walk and act differently. They will begin to be whole and be made brand new. God, we thank you, Father, for doing it for them today and doing it quickly. Then, God, we thank you that your word promises that you would write their names in the Lamb book of life and that the angels shall rejoice. So, Father, we thank you for the celebration that is going on right now for those that have decided to make you your Lord and Savior, for those that have decided to transition over to being your children, God, that are not hesitant, that trust you, and that will lean upon you from now until the day that you call them home. We pray, God, that you would surround them with people, Master, that will help them to know your word, that will help them to study, that will keep them accountable, oh God. Not people that have their own agenda about joining them to a fixing them to a building or to a church, but people that have the desire to compel them to draw closer to you, regardless of where they choose to fellowship or worship with. We thank you, O God, for the souls that were saved and that are being saved right now. Thank you for redeeming them, God, by the blood of Jesus. And Father, we pray for those that have known you but have settled in some capacity, that because of whatever issues that have happened in life, whatever experiences they had, that they've given up on the dream, that they've lost sight of the revelation. God, we ask that you would wipe off the mud, the dirt that is upon their lenses of their eyes, God, and give them clear vision, oh God, so they can see how to draw back closer to you. We thank you, God, for their desire to want to walk in your will, to want to be nearer to you. We thank you, God, for them not being afraid to show themselves unto you, to be vulnerable and open, God. So, Lord, we ask that you would reciprocate the love, Master, that you would reclaim them as your very own, that you would embrace them both spiritually and naturally, that you would command that every angel that is assigned to them to rejoice and to celebrate, oh God, that tears of joy flow from their bodies, oh God, that tears and mountains of sorrow and pain that they leave and dispersed from them right now. In Jesus' name, we thank you, God, for making them free, Master, for giving them new hopes and for restoring the vision, God. We thank you, God, that you have made them in your image and after your likeness and moved them back into the place of prominence. Then, God, we just ask that you would touch those that are walking in your will, that doing what you've recalled of them, that are not complaining, that trust and depend on you, that are working while there's night, working while there's day, oh God, that are doing what you've created them for, and they desire just to celebrate you, Lord. So we just offer you all of the praises, God. We say hallelujah and glory to your name, for you are worthy to be praised. You are the Almighty God, and there is none like you. Lord, we celebrate you today, and we thank you for all that you've done. We know that because you exist, that we have our being. And that we are only able to do because you have created us in a earthly body with supernatural abilities. Now let us see. Let us see ourselves in your arms and comforted. Let us see ourselves walking in newness. Let us see ourselves victorious. Let us see ourselves healed. Let us see ourselves free. Let us see ourselves loose from every bondage. But most importantly, let us see ourselves unstuck. We thank you. It's in the almighty name of Jesus Christ. We declare it to be so. Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God. So, wherever you are dismissed, we pray that God will use you, that God will continue to bless you and keep you. In Jesus' name, praise God.